Fine. So I think today's session is briefly about VivaVoce, so that what happens in the afternoon session of your exams, practical exams. So morning session, you do have your cases that are there, and you have the VivaVoce in the afternoon, and you generally have four stations of VivaVoce that is there. So the pattern defense, the patterns, sometimes you have instruments, drugs, charts, and then you have some universities you have ECGs that are kept, and in some universities there are slides, there are microscopy that is asked for, and case scenarios will be kept, and sometimes you have OSCE also. So various patterns are there, but I will try to cover quite the common ones that are important and which are more commonly found everywhere. Everywhere, what do we do? So I'll basically discuss with the instruments, the common X-rays, and some ECGs which are important for undergraduate level. Also, brief overview of the drugs that are commonly asked, and then some case scenarios and charts. If time permits, we will go through that. So, beginning with the instruments, so this is the common thing that is there. So, you have a set of instruments that will be kept to you, and you will be generally asked to pick one and then speak about it. So, whenever you pick up an instrument, you should be knowing to identify it, and you should know why is that instrument, how do you identify it, what are the features that it has, or what are the components that it has. You should know the procedure for which we have doing it. So what are the indications for the procedure, what are the contraindications of procedure, and briefly you should know about the procedure that would be there. So generally you have maybe 5 minutes per station that you have in your Viva, so it's not a long procedure that's there. So you should pick up the instrument that would you would be know thoroughly about, and the general questions which you know the answer. So that instrument, if they ask you to pick, you should preferably pick that. So the first instrument that is I'm displaying, so hope you're able to see the images. So this is the most instrument which will be there in almost all the instrument trays that you have, the spinal needle, or what we call it as the lumbar puncture needle. So the ones which you're seeing on your left are the old one, the metallic ones that you're seeing. The ones which we have now are the, this is the new ones which you have. So you have the spinal needle that's written there. So this is the lumbar puncture needle, and by
मैम
far
मेरा
this is
क्लास
the,
चल रहा है कितना
so by far this would be the easiest instrument to be picked, because there are standard set of questions that you can be asked and you can answer about it. So it has a needle. You have a needle here which has a beveled edge. You can see that the tip that's there, it's a beveled edge that is there, and you have a stilet. You have a stilet which fits snugly into the needle, so the stilet does not come out of the needle. And based on the gauge, so you have the higher the gauge, the thinner the needle that will be there. So that is what you have to understand. So the common questions they ask you is, what are the indications for this procedure? So please remember, lumbar puncture, you have therapeutic indications and diagnostic indications. Diagnostic indications are for diagnosis of meningitis, encephalitis. In some demyelinating diseases, we do the CSF to look for certain findings. You do the CSF whenever you have a pyrexia of unknown origin and you do not have a diagnosis, then maybe lumbar puncture is indicated. In leukemias and sometimes in lymphomas, lumbar puncture is indicated to look for if there is any central nervous system metastasis that happens. Also, sometimes in subarachnoid hemorrhage, though it's not an indication. So these are the diagnostic indications of lumbar puncture. The therapeutic indications of lumbar puncture, the most often one that we use is for the anesthesia and the obstetric analgesia. So you give the spinal anesthesia and the obstetric analgesia, you do the lumbar puncture for that. Also, intrathecal methotrexate in leukemias, acute leukemias, you give intrathecal methotrexate. So that is what is the therapeutic indications. Also, you have a condition called as normal pressure hydrocephalus. So you have elderly patients who come with ataxia, urinary incontinence, and dementia. And if you take a CT scan of their head, you find that the ventricles are dilated. So for that, treatment is to do a CSF tap, or you can do a ventricloperitoneal shunt, but ventricloperitoneal shunt would take some time. Maybe the surgery has to be scheduled and you may have to do the surgery later. But then in the emergency situation, you can do a diagnose a therapeutic lumbar puncture, and you can aspirate around 50 cc of the CSF slowly Okay, it has to be taken slowly. We can't tap that much so rapidly. And the patient will improve, the ataxia will improve, the urinary incontinence will improve. So all those things will improve if the patients, once you do the therapeutic lumbar puncture. So that is what you have to importantly remember. So these are the therapeutic indications. Earlier they used to give intrathecal antibiotics. We no longer give intrathecal antibiotics. So these are the indications. What are the contraindications for the lumbar puncture? Please remember the absolute contraindication is raised intracranial tension. So supposedly you have a raised intracranial tension. The patient has features of altered sensorium and you do a fundoscopy examination, you find papilledema there, or you do a CT scan and you find there's a lot of edema. In such condition, we are not supposed to do the lumbar puncture because you can cause catastrophic coning can happen and the patient can die. So lumbar puncture is contraindicated in a raised intracranial tension. So raised intracranial tension, you have the contraindication that's there. The other contraindications for lumbar puncture is whenever you have severe thrombocytopenia or coagulopathy, there is a chance that there could be a bleed that could be caused. So they are also absolute contraindications. The relative contraindications are if there is a problem at the site where you're doing the lumbar puncture, if you have some problems there, so that's a relative contraindication that could be there. Local site infections, or you could have local skeletal abnormalities that could be there. You can do it at some other site. Okay, so those are the relative contraindications. And patient's refusal, if the patient or the patient bystanders do not give you the consent, that's an absolute contraindication for any procedure. So please remember, for all procedures, you are supposed to take the consent, written informed consent. So if the patient is refusing, then that becomes an absolute contraindication for the procedure. So how do we do the lumbar puncture? So if you see the lumbar puncture, it's done. Okay, it's done in the lower intercostal spaces there. And there is a lower intercostal space. So you remember the spinal cord ends at the low border of L1 or upper border of L2. So anywhere below that, you have the conus medullaris that is there. So you have the entire, there is a bulbous enlargement that will be there. So there will be CSF space that is there. So anywhere below L2, you can do it. So the common site that we do is L2-3. L2-3 space is the common site. You can do it below that also. But sometimes if you do not be able to do in the lumbar region, you can do a cisternal puncture, but that cannot be done by on bedside. You might require some neurosurgical help for that. So you will have to do that because of that. So how do you identify? That's the most common question that they ask you. How do you identify the L2-3 space? So when the patient is lying down in lateral position, hope you're able to see this image. If you put your hand on the iliac crest, uppermost border of the iliac crest, you place it like this, the thumb will be in the L2-3 space. So that is how you identify when the patient is in the lateral position. When you keep your hand there, the thumb is going to be there in the L2-3 space. So that's how you identify it. That's the space you're going to identify. And then you're going to the normal procedure for any particular surgery, any procedure when you do, you would clean that area, you would paint that area, and then cover, drape it. And then you use the needle. Very important, how do you use the needle and what is the way you're supposed to put the needle? Please remember, the needle has to be put with the bevel edge facing the roof. Okay, please remember the bevel edge has to face the roof. The bevel part has to be facing upwards, not towards the patient head. Because by doing that, you are going to split. Remember, the nerve sheets are coming from craniocaudal. So they are flowing, there is a entire nerve sheet which is coming up. So when you put the needle with the bevel up, it's going to split the nerve sheet and then it's going to enter there. That's how it's going to enter. But if supposedly you put it the bevel edge facing the patient's head, what is going to do? It's going to cut the nerve roots. It's going to cut the nerve roots and enter. So whenever there is a cut the nerve roots and enter, there's a chance of CSF leak once you remove it. If supposedly you're doing it in the normal way where the bevel edge is facing the roof, when you remove it, the nerve fibers will come back to place and it might seal that area. So the bevel edge has to face the patient's, bevel edge has to face upwards, that is the roof. And what are the second question they ask you is, what are the structures that you pierce when you reach the space? So from outside to in the region, structures that you have to pierce when you reach the space. So you have the skin, the subcutaneous tissue that is there. And then you have the supraspinous ligament. That's the supraspinous ligament that will be there. And then you have between the vertebrae, you could have the interspinous ligament that could be there. And as you come towards, the first area that you'll be coming towards is the ligamentum flavum that's there right in front there. And moment you enter the ligamentum flavum, the first layer that you're going to pass through, that is what you get. What is the layer which will be the most outside layer? Will be the arachnoid. And then when you pierce that dura mater, the moment you pierce the dura mater, that is where you feel the give way. You'll feel that the give way. Moment you pierce the dura mater, the outermost layer there, you will be, there will be a sensation of give way that you get. So those are the layers that you pass through. And till then you're keeping the stilet. Moment you feel that give way, you can release or you can remove the stilet and you should be able to see the clear CSF coming. If you're not able to see that, you're supposed to put the stilet back and reposition the needle. You can put it a little forwards or backwards. And if you're still not being getting, you have to remove it totally and then try it in a separate area. So that's how you do the lumbar puncture. And that's the layers what the lumbar puncture needle will penetrate. So this is how it's done. So left lateral decubitus position, and then you can do that. The first thing what you're supposed to do when you do a CSF analysis is supposed to measure the CSF pressure. Now, it's a very simple instrument that you have. Some of you would have seen it maybe in your wards whenever you've done it. So you connect it to a three-way and you connect it to a tubing like your BP apparatus manometer there. And the CSF will enter from the lumbar puncture through the three-way. It will go up so you can direct it and you can measure the CSF pressure. So CSF pressure is important to measure because in meningitis it is elevated. As we discussed that time, normal pressure hydrocephalus where you have dilated ventricles but the pressure will be normal. So it's important for us to note the CSF pressure. And once the CSF pressure is recorded in centimeters or millimeters based on what is the grading that's there on the tube that you have, then you can collect the sample for various analysis. So generally we collect it in three tubes. The first one is for the culture and gram stain. Next is the glucose protein and cell count and differential count. And the specific, like TB meningitis, we would send the CSF for ADA level or a CBNAC level. If you are suspecting fungal, then we do a KOH mount possibly. Or cryptococcal meningitis, we do a specific India ink test. So these tests we do, and that is where your tests are supposed to be done. So this is how you calculate the CSF pressure. Okay, so that's how you are supposed to do it. And then very importantly, before you remove the needle back, reinsert the stilet and then remove the needle in one position. Give a tight compression there. You can give a seal there and cleanse and cover the puncture site. Complications of lumbar puncture, very important, is what we call it as a post-spinal headache. Almost all patients who undergo a lumbar puncture do complain of a post-spinal headache. And that's basically based because of the leak of the CSF. Once we have removed the tubing, the tract that is formed, there could be some amount of CSF leak and that produces the headache. So how do we minimize this headache? So the thing that we have to do is we should make sure that the patient is adequately hydrated before the procedure. There is no dehydration, so there should be adequate hydration. So make sure that the patient is hydrated well. Second is use the thinnest possible needle. Use the thinnest possible needle as the gauge that is there. Thinnest possible needle that is available, you should use that. Next is you have to use the needle properly. As I told you, the bevel edge has to face the roof, not the patient's head. So that when you remove the needle back, the fibers will come back and seal the rent that is there. If you do it in the other way around, there will be a aperture that is placed there, and because of that CSF leak can happen. Also make sure the patient at least lies down supine for at least 2 to 3 hours after the procedure. Patient should not be allowed to sit up, should lie down, and you should maintain adequate hydration of the patient even after the procedure that is there. And you can give some analgesics. Now if supposedly you have done multiple punctures and you know that the CSF leak is going to happen, or in patients where you have normal pressure hydrocephalus, you keep the needle there for a longer time. You keep that needle there and you connect it to a small gauged thing, and where the CSF slowly comes out over half an hour, you collect that 50 ml of CSF. 15 or 40, half an hour, you slowly collect it. In such conditions, you know that there is going to be a defect that is there. Okay, you know that there is, you have already created a rent that is there. So what you're supposed to do when you know that there is going to be a leak that's going to happen, when you anticipate it, before you remove the needle out, you're supposed to take a cc, one cc of the blood of the patient, self-patient's blood, and inject it into the needle. So you take one cc of patient's blood and inject it into the needle. So that what happens, moment the blood reaches the space there, it clots and it forms a patch. It prevents the CSF leak. So whenever we have anticipating a rent that is going to cause CSF leak and cause headache, we do something called as an autologous blood patch. So before removing the needle, you can put a autologous blood patch, patient's blood itself, you can inject it, that will clot there and it will prevent the CSF leak. You can't do it after removing the needle, you have to puncture it again, so that won't work. So this, if you anticipate, you can do it early. Yes, you can give hydration, you can give analgesics, caffeine, etc. will help, but most important is patient should lie down for at least 2 to 3 hours after procedure, and you have to make sure that the patient takes good enough fluid intake. Okay, if the patient is not taking orally, you will have to give it intravenous. The other complications, though not common, if you are not careful and you do a lot of CSF comes out, the patient can go into coning and the patient can have apnea. Back pain could be there at the site. Bleeding or fluid leak around the spinal canal. Infections, pain, hematoma can occur. Rare complications are the epidermis cyst. Sometimes ocular muscle palsy, that's because of the coning down. Nerve trauma can happen. And brainstem herniation is a serious side effect. Very importantly, you will have to know the normal findings of the CSF and the CSF findings in various meningitis conditions. So please remember the normal CSF pressure is around 90 to 80 millimeters of mercury. If you take it as pressures in centimeters of water, it will be around 15 to 20 centimeters of water. Normal cells are only lymphocytes up to 5 lymphocytes. Okay, upper limit is 8, 5 lymphocytes is normal. Protein is around 45 milligrams. Glucose, please remember, glucose does not have a specific value. It should be 2/3 of the plasma glucose. So whenever you do the CSF, simultaneously you should check the sugar. You should check the sugar simultaneously. Only then you'll be able to make out whether the CSF is, the blood glucose and the CSF glucose is matrix. So CSF glucose is 2/3 of the plasma glucose. Chloride is around 115 to 130 milliequivalents. Okay. Now, the important features they ask you is the features that you get in case of bacterial, viral, and tuberculous meningitis. All of you would have known this. Remember, the cells are increased in all. In bacterial meningitis, it is predominantly neutrophilic in early stages. Later, it could be lymphocytic, but predominantly neutrophilic. The cell count could be more than 10,000 also. Protein is very much elevated. The glucose is low and the chloride is low. That is what you have to remember. Whereas in viral meningitis, the pressure is increased. Cells are increased, but not very high. The protein is normal to mildly increased. The glucose is normal. This is what you have to remember. Glucose is normal in case of viral meningitis. The chloride is also normal because the viruses do not use the metabolism that's happening. So both the glucose and the chloride is normal. That would happen in case of viral. In tuberculous meningitis, please remember you have the cobweb formation. Cobweb formation, very characteristic that you have. Which would be there in tuberculous meningitis. That's because of the increased protein. You will have lymphocytes. The cell count will not be above 1,000, but you will have lymphocyte that could be there. Protein will be very much elevated. Glucose will be decreased and the chloride will be decreased. So the difference is between viral and tuberculous meningitis, because both are lymphocytes. How you differentiate is by the glucose. Glucose is normal in case of viral, and the glucose is decreased in tuberculous. And very importantly, the pressure is very much increased, as well as the protein cobweb formation that you could get. Fungal meningitis would mimic tuberculous meningitis, and earlier syphilis was common, so used to get syphilitic meningitis, which could have some features of a chronic meningitis. So meningitis, this is the picture that you get. Encephalitis is again like a viral fever. So encephalitis will have all features like a viral meningitis. That The other common indication that CSF has done is GB syndrome. So in GB syndrome, what do you get in the CSF? A very characteristic finding in the CSF you get in GB syndrome, what we call it as the albuminocytological dissociation. So always remember the CSF protein. So CSF protein and the cells go hand in hand. If there are more cells, the protein is increased. More cells, protein is increased. If the cells are normal, protein will not be increased. But in GB syndrome, there is no infection. So the cells will be normal. The protein is coming from the demyelination of the radicals. The radicals are demyelination. The protein is the myelin that is coming. So the protein will be elevated, but the cells will not be increased. Very characteristic of GB syndrome. It's one of the diagnostic things of GB syndrome that you have to remember. Other common questions they ask you is, what is the CSF finding in case of subarachnoid hemorrhage? So in subarachnoid hemorrhage, the blood is there in the CSF space for a long time. So when you aspirate or the CSF comes out, it gets a yellowish tinge that you get. You get something called as xanthochromia. Xanthochromia, that is what you see in case of a spinal subarachnoid hemorrhage that is seen. So again, a common question they ask you, how do you differentiate subarachnoid hemorrhage versus a traumatic tap? So when you're doing a CSF puncture itself, you might get blood there. So is that subarachnoid hemorrhage or not? So very importantly, in case of subarachnoid hemorrhage, all the samples will be uniformly colored. The color, first sample, second sample, third sample coming will be uniformly colored. Whereas in the traumatic tap, only the initial part, samples will be colored. Later it will clear. Again, as I said, xanthochromia, that is due to the degenerated of the RBCs, the bilirubin pigments which is coming, is characteristic of subarachnoid hemorrhage. We do not find it in case of a traumatic tap. Third, when we do a microscopy and you see the RBCs, in case of a traumatic tap, you will have fresh RBCs. RBCs will be normally shaped. Whereas in subarachnoid hemorrhage, the RBCs will be already lysed. So you will be able to see the lysed RBCs that you get. So these are the findings that are there in a CSF. And these are the common questions that they ask you. Hope it is clear. So CSF, you have a set of standard questions that are going to be asked. So it's always, if they ask you to pick an instrument, please pick the lumbar puncture and that will be easy for you to answer. The next needles that are kept is your bone marrow aspiration and bone marrow biopsy needles. Okay. So bone marrow aspiration and bone marrow biopsy needles that you have. So remember, the bone marrow aspiration needles are a small stout needles. The biopsy needles are a tall, it has a hold here, okay, because your biopsy are going to pierce the bone and take a piece of the bone. So it requires a little of pressure. So you have a hold like this that is there. So if you see the bone marrow aspiration needle, so you have a needle that is there. You have a stilet that is there inside there. And there is a guard. There is a guard here, which is adjustable. In some of the needles, it is fixed, but some of the needles, it is adjustable guard. So adjustable so that you can fix the length of the needle that goes inside the bone. That's why this guard is adjustable. That's there. So this is how a bone marrow aspiration needle would look like. So again, you have to know the indications for bone marrow aspiration. It's done usually in diagnosis of anemia, cytopenias, thrombocytopenias, or when the counts are elevated, leukemias, thrombocytosis, or whenever there is polycythemia, you'd be doing that. Bone marrow is also done in PUO, diagnosis of pyrexia of unknown origin. You do the bone marrow for that also. So these are the common indications that are there for bone marrow aspiration that is there. Okay. Contraindications for bone marrow aspiration. Please remember, there is no absolute contraindication for bone marrow because we have multiple sites. It's not at one site that you do. Unless the patient is refusing, that's the only absolute contraindication for a bone marrow aspiration. Even if you have a platelet count which is low, even if the platelet count is less than 10,000, marrow is, it bleeds into the marrow, and if the clotting functions are fine, okay, the clot will form there because there is, it's a closed space you're bleeding into. So even severe thrombocytopenia is not a contraindication for bone marrow. In patients with leukemias, etc., even with platelet counts which are less, we do the bone marrow. So bone marrow can still be done with low platelet counts. However, coagulopathy, if the INR is prolonged or the APTD is prolonged, double, more than double the times, then it's a little difficult or it's a complication of bleeding can happen in that case. Okay. What are the sites that you do the bone marrow in? So very importantly, the common site that we do in adults is the iliac crest. So anywhere in the iliac crest, you can do it. But the most common site we do is the posterior superior iliac spine, because that's easy when the patient is prone, lying down prone. You can see those dimples at the back. So that's the posterior superior iliac spine. You can do that there. You can do that even in the anterior superior iliac spine. You can do it anywhere in the iliac crest because that's a flat bones. So marrow in adults can be done in all flat bones. The easiest is the sternum. But the problem with sternum is it's a very superficial bone. And by chance, you use a little more pressure there, you can go through and through the sternum and it can directly hit the aorta that's there or the cardia that's there and the patient can die. So we have had instances where this has happened, that sternal puncture can cause that, especially when you have a little elderly persons who have a little of osteoporotic bones. The sternal puncture is not very safe in that case. But yes, you can do it. In children, we do still sternal punctures. And if you do it carefully, nothing will happen there. Only osteoporotic bones, etc., it's a little risky there. Iliac crest is safe because there is no major vessel that's around there. You can easily do the puncture. Even if you penetrate a little more, you will not damage any major structure there. In children, you can also do it in the tibial tuberosity. But in adults, you do it only in the iliac crest, the posterior superior iliac spine, etc. So again, this is a very painful procedure because you're entering the bone. So adequate analgesia, etc. has to be given. Lignocaine has to be given. And I think all of you have seen the procedure that's being done. Please remember the marrow, the color of the marrow is like blood. So how do you differentiate whether it's the marrow or it is the blood that is coming? Because there is sinusoid with bloods that is there. Sinusoids that is there. So blood. So how do you identify that the marrow is there? Make sure that when you aspirate the sample, you put it on a glass petri dish. Okay. Or you can use liquid EDTA. You should make sure it does not clot. Remember, your powder EDTA that we use for blood may not be sufficient. Ideally, we are supposed to mix it immediately with liquid EDTA. And then you can make a slide of it, or you can see on the petri dish, you should get flat globules. You should be able to see the flat globules that is there. If flat globules are there, that means this is a marrow that is, this is a marrow that has good particles. Okay, that has good particles. And then remember, the bone marrow aspiration sample is always sent in liquid EDTA. Liquid EDTA is the sample that's used. Sometimes when we are sending this for certain analysis, like you have a genetic analysis sometimes for leukemias, we do various tests that are done under the, you do the CD markers, etc. In such samples, which has to be transmitted to centers where it are a little far away, you can use heparin. You can use heparin for the for mixing it so that it does not get clotted. Otherwise, liquid EDTA is the mixing substance that we use. Usually, no major complications. You can have local pain. Sometimes infection can occur. Otherwise, no major complications. Now, this is the bone marrow biopsy needle. As I told, it's a long needle that is there. And it has a hold at this end. It doesn't have a guard. Procedure is same as the bone marrow. You are doing it in the iliac crest only. Now, when do you do a bone marrow biopsy? Now, please remember, in bone marrow aspiration, we are seeing the cells. We are only able to see the cells that are there. So you can make out the abnormal cells. You can see the cellularity, etc. But the architecture of the bone marrow, if you want to see whether the architecture, whether there is any diffuse disease that is there, you want to see a histopathology sort of feature that is there. In such conditions, you want to know the marrow that's fully there. In such conditions, you require a bone marrow biopsy. Supposedly, you have a granuloma you want to see, tuberculosis or lymphoma you want to see, or you want to see any storage diseases that are there. In such conditions, you are expected to do the bone marrow biopsy. Also, sometimes when you do a bone marrow aspiration, you get a dry tap. Now, what do you mean by a dry tap? You're in the marrow, but you're aspirating, you're not getting anything. Now, why does the dry tap happen? So dry tap happens for two reasons. Either the marrow does not have any particles, okay? That is called as a myelofibrosis, where the marrow does not have any particles. It is dry, so you won't get it. Or else the marrow is totally packed with cells. It is jam-packed with cells, okay? When you have packed cells that are there, in such condition, what happens, even if you aspirate it, it's not going to displace the cells. So whenever there's a leukemia which is there, which is totally cells are too much in that, or when there is an anemia you have, and as a part of the anemia, the marrow is reacting, reactive hyperplasia happens. Even such condition, you can have a dry tap. But please, in the exam, if they ask you what is the cause of dry tap, please mention it as myelofibrosis. So myelofibrosis is a condition where the marrow is replaced by fiber, fibrous tissue that is there. So fiber is there. So the cells are absent in such condition. So that is the condition where you can get a dry tap. So whenever there's a dry tap, you're supposed to do a bone marrow biopsy. Again, you have to know the marrow findings that you get in common conditions. What do you get in iron deficiency? Again, remember, you have erythroid hyperplasia and the bone marrow iron stores will be diminished. The stain that we use for the bone marrow iron store is the Prussian blue stain that we use. What will you get in megaloblastic anemia? You'll get the megaloblasts. That's what you can see there. In leukemias, you get the precursor cells that you get. So you have to know. In myeloma, what do you get? You get plasma cells that are there, atypical plasma cells, or the plasma blasts you get. So you have to know the bone marrow findings in some common diseases also. That's about bone marrow aspiration and biopsy. Hopefully that is clear. Again, remember, the bone marrow aspiration, biopsy needle, you have the needle, and then that's a stilet, and then you have a one more longer stilet. Now here, this is to make sure once the piece is taken, to remove that piece from the needle, we use this longer stilet that is there. Okay. Next, this is a needle which was used earlier. We don't use it anymore. Anybody, what is this needle? Anybody can?
Liver biopsy needle.
Yes. So this is the liver biopsy needle. Okay. Liver biopsy needle goes by the name of Wim Silverman. So you can see here, it has a needle that is there, and this is a stilet, and the stilet is a biphalange. It has two phalanges that's there. So this was the needle which was used for liver biopsy earlier. We no longer use this. We use much more atraumatic procedures now. So, but this was the Wim Silverman, Wim Silverman, Wim Silverman liver biopsy needle. You have to know because it's kept in the exam set. What we use now for liver biopsy is this smaller needles. This is the true cut needles that are available. Okay. This can be used for any biopsy, be it liver biopsy or kidney biopsy. You use the very, very fine needles that are there. Okay. Menzies needle, that has a name for it also. And this is the much atraumatic, and we now do the procedure under guidance. Under the ultrasound guidance, we do. Both kidney and liver biopsy can be done by using this needle. And presently for the kidney biopsy, you have this kidney biopsy gun. Okay. In most of the centers, this is available. And it's like a very fine needle where you can fix the distance and you can go inside and take the piece and it comes. So it's like a gun. It's a kidney biopsy gun. With this, you can do the liver biopsy also. So you have to know the indications for liver biopsy. So what are the common indications for liver biopsy? Whenever you have conditions, you want to know the liver histology, where you have hepatitis, whether it is what's the cause of hepatitis or cause of cirrhosis. Or hepatocellular carcinoma, the gold standard test is the liver biopsy that you do. Whenever you have hepatomegaly without any cause, storage disorders, leukemias, lymphoma, such things you may have to know, do a liver biopsy. Pyrexia of unknown origin, you'll have to do a liver biopsy. So these are the common indications for liver biopsy. Again, it's not a very common procedure that is done. Now, very important, you have to know the contraindications for the liver biopsy. Any bleeding disorder, any clotting disorder, because liver is a very vascular structure, and if you touch there and take a small piece also, if there's a bleeding or a clotting, it will bleed into the peritoneum and the patient can die because of intraperitoneal hemorrhage. So it is a very, very important thing that we have to rule out. So because of that, liver biopsy is not done so often, because many of the hepatitis patients or many of the liver disease patients have significant coagulopathy there. Some of them have severe thrombocytopenia also. And any lesion you suspect in the liver, which is vascular, again, that can bleed. So you have to avoid liver biopsy. Also, if you find that the biliary radicals are dilated on ultrasound, you do. You find intrahepatic biliary radicals are dilated. Then you can't touch the liver, because the moment if it passes the biliary radicals, it will cause biliary peritonitis, and that is a sure shot mortality. The patients won't survive that. So you have to be very, very careful about that also. Okay. So this is the common things that you have to know about liver biopsy. Kidney biopsy is done for glomerulonephritis and sometimes cancers. So those were the needles that you had. Next, you have certain of the tubings. This is what we call it as the nasogastric tube or the Ryle's tube. Okay, this is the older version of the Ryle's tube which you have. It's a feeding tube that we use. So it has a tube that's there, and it used to have this lead bearings. Now we don't get this lead bearings. This lead bearings were used for gravity. Okay, when you pass it through the mouth or the nose, and with the heaviness of that, it would reach the stomach easily. That's why the lead bearings were used. Now we do not have that. You have multiple eyes that are there. So you have multiple 1, 2, 3 eyes are there. And then you have this green color line. Now, why is this green color line there on the Ryle's tube? It is for radiological identification. So that's the radiopaque line. The rest of the tube is radiolucent. If you take an X-ray, you'll be able to see that line. So that is the why that line is used for. And again, you have markings on the Ryle's tube. All of you would have seen this. So the markings would correspond to the esophagogastric junction, the fundus of the stomach, as well as the duodenum junction. Based on that, it's the distance from the incisor. From the incisor, the distances. There are three markings that are there. So based on that, you know where the tip of the gastric lavage tube that is there. So indications of gastric lavage. Again, it could be indications which are diagnostic. It could be therapeutic indications. Now, diagnostic indications is if you want to aspirate and see something that is there in the stomach. So you can put it and aspirate it there. The treatment indications more often for feeding that we use it. Patient is unconscious, is not able to swallow. You can use this for feeding. You can put it there. So multiple openings are kept because some of the openings can get clogged. And after that, you may not be able to use it. So multiple openings so that the patient's feeding, etc. keeps happening there. Again, very importantly, what are the contraindications for putting the Ryle's tube? Whenever you suspect a varices that is there, you should never put a Ryle's tube. Whenever you suspect a corrosive injury, okay, corrosive injury, phenol the patient has consumed or acid the patient has consumed, in such conditions, you should not put the Ryle's tube inside. You should be very careful in that. You should not pass anything. Can this be used for gastric lavage in a poisoning? Again, remember, this is a very narrow bore tube that is there. Though we still use this for gastric lavage, this is not the gastric lavage tube. Lavage has to be given with a wide bore tube, so that all the things come out easily. Here, since it's a narrow bore tube and this openings can get blocked with various things, lavage may not be very much successful by doing with the Ryle's tube. But yes, we still do this. We use it for gastric lavage. So that's about the Ryle's tube. This is the gastric lavage tube that is used. This is the older gastric lavage tube that was used for stomach wash in poisoning patients. So whenever you have a poisoning patient that's there and stomach wash has to be given, this is the tube that is used for that. Please remember the contraindications for gastric lavage. Whenever a patient has taken corrosives, be it acid or be it alkali, in such conditions, we do not do the gastric lavage. That's absolute contraindication. Kerosene poisoning is again a contraindication because when you put this, what happens is the sphincters will open up and the kerosene vapors can come up and it can cause chemical pneumonitis. Again, convulsion. If a patient is convulsing, it's a risk of passing this inside because you can cause aspiration. And if the patient has any unstable spine, okay, cervical spine, etc. is unstable, so you would not will to pass such a big tube that is there. So again, when this tube is kept, they may ask you the complications. The complications are, it can perforate, okay, it can perforate the esophagus of the stomach and it cause peritonitis and mediastinitis and such complication. It can cause hemorrhage that could be there. And they can ask you about the various antidotes for various poisons. Okay, so common antidotes for poison, commonly available poisons that are there, and the antidotes for that will be asked. There's one more gastric lavage tube. One is the Ewald's one. This is the other one is a Boas. Mild difference is there. Doesn't have a siphon. So it has a funnel. This has a siphon and this is the tube. So this end goes into the stomach. This remains at the oral cavity, above the outside of the oral cavity. And then you connect this funnel and then you put the saline through this and lift that up so that the entire saline goes inside. And then you can remove this funnel end and connect this empty tubing down. and siphon it out so that the entire secretions come out. So that's how you use this gastric Lavage tube. Next is the endotracheal tube. Okay, this is the endotracheal tube. All of you would have seen in your operation theater. So this is a cuffed endotracheal tube. You can see this cuff. So this is used for endotracheal intubation. It can be done for comatose patients. It can be done for anesthesia, general anesthesia when you are giving. So you can do the cuffed endotracheal tube can be used for various indications. Please remember, you inflate the cuff with air. Now, why do you inflate the cuff? So that it does not allow aspiration. So it becomes the aspirate secretions don't go back down there and the tube remains there and there is no aspiration is prevented. So cuffed endotracheal tube is to prevent aspiration. Please remember that this is inflated, the cuff is inflated with air. Do not say saline or sterile water for the endotracheal tube. So this is the laryngoscopes. You have the various types of laryngoscopes that you have. The McIntosh, that's the curved ones that you see here. So this is used for endotracheal intubation or for airways to clear the airways or to make sure that there is any foreign body. If it is there, you'll have to remove it or whatever. So use that for that. So endotracheal intubation, use the laryngoscope that is used. Okay. This one is the AMBU bag. Okay. So AMBU bag, the full form of AMBU is the ambulatory breathing mask unit. So that's the AMBU bag that is there. So using the AMBU bag, that's used for mechanical ventilation. When you, before you intubate, you secure the airway that is there. And you can keep the bag mask there. You can connect it to oxygen and that can help in breathing. It's used during the resuscitation. When you do the cardiopulmonary resuscitation also, you use the AMBU bag that's there. Next, you have the tracheostomy tubes. So the tracheostomy tubes. So again, this is tracheostomy or the metallic tracheostomy. You have the Potex tracheostomy tubes that are available also. So the metallic tracheostomy tubes and the Potex tracheostomy tubes that are available. Please remember, this is used whenever you find that the ventilation is needed for a longer time. If you need ventilation for more than maybe 7 to 10 days, more than 7 to 10 days, if the patient requires ventilation, in such conditions, you will require tracheostomy to be done. And such conditions, you will require the tracheostomy tubes. Presently, we use the Potex tubes, but these are the metallic tracheostomy tubes. So it can be done wherever the neurological conditions is there where it requires prolonged ventilation. Okay, so this is one more instrument, is what we call it as a urinometer. Again, we do not use it so often now. You would have seen it in your biochemistry labs. It is used for measuring the specific gravity of the urine. So this is used to measure the specific gravity of urine. So whenever a urinometer is kept, they will ask you about urine routine examination. What is proteinuria? What are the tests that we do in the urine for sugar, the ketone bodies, other things will be asked. And specific gravity, what is isosthenuria? Isosthenuria? What is isosthenuria? Anybody?
Yes, of course.
Yes, what is isosthenuria?
Specific gravity will be fixed, sir, in case of tubular injury.
Okay, the specific gravity is fixed to 1010. So 1010 specific gravity, it's classically seen for chronic kidney disease. So whenever you have a CKD, in CKD, you do get this fixed specific gravity of 1010. That is what you get that. So, okay. Sometimes this one more needle is kept and this is what we call it as a pleural biopsy needle. Not all the instrument struts you get this. Now, how do you differentiate it from any of the other needles is it has a hook at the end. So please remember it has a hook like this. This is called as a Abraham Copes, C-O-P-E-S, Copes needle. So it has a hook there. So it is used for pleural biopsy. This is used for pleural biopsy. So Copes, pleural biopsy needle, that is what is there. So any indications where you have recurrent pleural effusions or there's a pleural mass that's there, in such conditions, we do this pleural biopsy by using this needle. Okay, coming on to the urinary catheters, the commonest one that you have is the Foley's catheter. Foley's catheter is a silicone catheter that is used, and you can have a two-way or a three-way catheter. I think you would have seen in surgical sets, you can have a three-way catheter. The third is used for the bladder irrigation. Normal ones which we use is the two-way catheter that is used here. And important question that they ask you is, how do you inflate the bulb? Very important. You inflate the bulb with sterile water. Please remember, it's not saline. It's not air. It is sterile water is used to inflate the bulb. You instill 20 to 25 cc of sterile water to inflate the bulb. Now, why not saline and why not air? Yeah, sterile water or distilled water. Why not air? Because if you instill it with air, this part will float on the urine and this tip will be out. So it will not serve the purpose of drainage. Why not saline? Because you're going to keep this catheter inside for 7 to 10 days. The saline can crystallize inside there and then you may not be able to deflate the bulb. You may not be able to deflate the bulb. So that is why we do not use saline or air. Now, supposedly the bulb is blocked or you're not able to deflate it when you want to remove it after maybe 7 days, 10 days. You can keep this Foley's catheter for around 14 days. And you have a silicone Foley's catheter that's available, which can be kept for around 8 weeks. You can keep it. So that's how you can use it. What are the indications of putting the Foley's catheter? So Foley's catheter is indicated whenever you have a retention of urine. So it could be neurological causes. It could be trauma. It could be perioperative. It could be postoperative. Whenever there is a retention of urine expected, that's where you use the Foley's catheter. And that's used for the urinary drainage. Very importantly, what are the contraindications for putting the Foley's catheter? If you find bleeding, if there is a bleeding or if you see the blood at the meatus, if you find that there is a bleeding spot at the meatus that is there, you should not venture into putting the catheter. So, or you suspect a stricture that is there. So such conditions, or there is a trauma to the pelvis and you expect a urethral injury, you do not do the Foley's catheterization. In such conditions, you are expected to do a suprapubic cystostomy. You're supposed to do a SPC directly. What are the complications of Foley's catheterization? You can get urinary tract infections. You can damage the urethra. The urethral injury can be there. And this could be the various complications that could be there of Foley's catheterization. The other catheter that you have is what we call it as a Mallet-Cotts catheter or a Mallet-Cotts catheter. This is also a self-retaining. It has an umbrella sort of thing at the tip there. So when you pass it, you pull it up and push it in and that will retain there. So again, we do not use it for long catheterization. This Mallet-Cotts catheter usually used in the surgery for abscess drainages. Whenever you have an abscess there and you want to put a drain in the abscess, such conditions use the Mallet-Cotts catheter. Other common instruments that you have your hemoglobinometer. All of you would have seen this hemoglobinometer. It's called as a Sally's hemoglobinometer, where we are using this for a measurement of hemoglobin. So hemoglobin is measured by this. So the method that we use for hemoglobin estimation is the acid hematin method. So using hydrochloric acid here, and then the color changes that you're going to look for. And based on that, you calculate the hemoglobin. So whenever this instrument is asked, they'll ask you about hemoglobin. Normal, what is anemia, types of anemias, polycythemias, etc. can be asked. They can ask you about that. This is a suction catheter. You could get metallic suction catheters or you can have this plastic suction catheters. These are used for suctioning. This could be used for suctioning of the oral cavity. It can be used for suctioning of the endotracheal tube. So these could be used for suctioning to prevent the secretions for remaining there. So this is the suction catheter that we use. The other two common syringes that are kept in the exam are the 1 cc syringes. Okay, these are small 1 cc syringes that are kept. One is the insulin syringe. The other one is the tuberculin syringe. Both of these are 1 cc syringes. Please remember how to differentiate them is the markings that are there. In insulin syringe, you will have the markings as 10, 20, 30 like that. Or 10, 20 till 100, it can be there. 40 or 100, two varieties could be there. Whereas in a tuberculin syringe, the markings are 0.1, 0.2, 0.3. So the difference is the markings. Again, you'll have to know about the tuberculin test. How do you give the tuberculin test? I think we have discussed it in one of the earlier sessions, the relevance and how do you read the tuberculin and what is the positive tuberculin test and what are the for fallacies of tuberculin test. Very common question asked both in medicine and pediatrics. Tuberculin test is asked, or the Mantoux test. This is the Nubar chamber. It's used for the cell counts. It's used for the cell count. Again, they'll ask you about the various WBC, normal counts, platelets, RBC counts, what is normal, what is elevated, and what are the abnormalities that you can get. That's all asked. This is the Vestergen tube. This is used for ESR measurement. So you have to know about the ESR measurement. You should know what's normal ESR. What are the conditions where you can have ESR above the 100? So what conditions you have ESR above 100, you should be knowing. So ESR above 100 is commonly seen with the myeloma, multiple myeloma, tuberculosis, giant cell arteritis, chronic kidney disease. So these are some conditions where the ESR is above 100. That is what you have to know. So I think these are the common instruments that are kept. Other than that, you can have your IV set that can be kept where you have your tubing that's there. You can have, the tubings could have various connectors. You can have an injection port. You can have a covered connector that could be there. You have the V-track controller that controls the amount of drops that is going. You have a filter there and a drip chamber. And then you have an access port and the final is a spike. So this is what goes into the bottle. And this is what goes into your needle, which you're, or the IV cannula that you're going to connect. So this is the IV set needle used for various infusions. Please remember the parts, the tubings, the ports, the V-track controller, the filter, the drip chamber, and the access port that is there. This is an oxygen mask. So used for delivering oxygen, various flows. So it's a oronasal mask that is there. So it's used for oxygen delivery. So you should know what are the indications for oxygen delivery, what are the various types of oxygen delivery system that can are available, what is high flow, what is NRBM, all those things you should know about. The other common things are the respiratory devices which are kept. This is the meter dose inhaler, okay, the oldest device that we have, the MDI, the meter dose inhaler that is there. So please remember, this is used for inhalation agent for obstructive airway disease, asthma or COPD. You can use inhaled bronchodilators. You can use inhaled steroids. And also you have N-acetylcysteine that's available as inhaled solutions that could be there. So this is the meter dose inhaler, the oldest one. It has a canister, it has an outer tubing, and it has a mouthpiece. This is the canister where the drug is placed. So the canister is where the drug is placed. This is the spacer that is there, especially in children, because the inhalation technique may not be appropriate. So to avoid wastage of the drug, use a spacer, and that's, this is the spacer that is used. This is the nebulizer. Again, when the patient is admitted or in acute respiratory distress, we use this nebulizer for various inhaled therapies that are there. You have to know the names of the inhaled drugs. You have to know the names of the inhaled corticosteroids, inhaled a bronchodilator, all those things. You have to know what are the common ones that are used. Please remember, inhaled bronchodilators, the steroids, budesonide, you could have, you have beclomethasone, you have betamethasone, which can be also given there, and the beta agonists, formoterol, salmeterol, salbutamol, which is a short acting, long actings are the salmeterol and the formoterol. The other inhaled are the fluticasone and flunisolide. Other than that, you can have the muscarinic antagonist, that is the ipratropium and thiotropium that can be given, and also N-acetylcysteine that can be given as an inhalational therapy. So these are the various inhaled systems that you have. So as we have discussed, the first one that we have is the dry powder inhaler, which was there earlier. You could have the various types of inhalers that are available in the market now. You could have the Easyhaler, Turbohaler, Discus. You have the aerolizer here, the Rotadisc and Novelizer. All of them are for inhaled therapies. Okay. So that's about the common instruments that are kept. They do ask you about the, not only the instruments, the indication, sometimes what is used, and based on the drugs also they can ask you. Let's briefly go on to the next set that we are doing. That is the common ECGs that are kept. And what is important for you undergraduate level is the ischemia, arrhythmias. Ischemia and arrhythmias, these are the two common things that they commonly ask you. And how do you calculate the rate? How do you calculate the rhythm? And how do you calculate the axis? So it's ECG is a full long class, so it's pretty difficult to finish in this session, but I'll try to give you some examples. If you see this ECG, what is the finding that you're getting in this ECG? If you see, you're finding that there is ST segment elevations. Okay. You're finding that there is ST segment elevations. You can see that in lead 1, lead AVL, lead V2, V3, V4, V5, V6. So you're finding that this patient has ST elevation in leads that are there. So this is possibly a MI, ST elevation MI. And based on the leads that is involved, you have 1 AVL, V2 to V6. So this is belonging to the territory called as anterolateral MI. So it's an ST elevation anterolateral MI that you're seeing on this ECG. So this patient comes with chest pain and you find that there is ST elevations in a vascular territory. This is what is MI. So this is the commonest ECG that is kept. So they'll ask you about what are the other tests that you will do and how do you manage and what are the complications. So you have to know the management of MI and the complications that could occur. Also, you have to know some conditions where the ST segment can elevate other than MI. So non-MI causes of ST segment elevation, common causes, pericarditis. Pericarditis can produce ST segment elevation. You have a condition called as benign early repolarization can produce ST segment elevation. You can get ST segment elevations when there is chamber enlargement, bundle branch blocks. But remember, MI and pericarditis are the two common causes of ST segment elevation. Okay, so here again, we have an ECG which is showing ST segment elevation. But again, here the ST segment elevation in lead 2, lead 3 and lead AVF. So 2, 3 AVF, you're getting ST segment elevation. So 2, 3 AVF belongs to inferior wall. So this is an acute inferior wall MI, inferior wall MI. So 2, 3 AVF, you're finding ST segment elevation. So this is an inferior wall MI. Okay, so after MI, you should know a little about the arrhythmias that could be there. So here you find that the heart rate is very much prolonged. Please remember, how do you calculate the heart rate is you have to calculate the between the RRs, between the two Rs, how much large squares are there, and then you divide it by 300. So here, if you see the number of large squares between the two Rs are two large squares are there. So if I take the formula 300 divided by 2, the heart rate is 150. So here we have a tachycardia. The heart rate is very much increased. Tachycardia is there. And the QRS complexes is very narrow. So this is called as a narrow complex tachycardia. So the most important causes, narrow complex tachycardia, is what we call it as an SVT. SVT, supraventricular tachycardia. Okay. You see, this is regular, very regular. And there is a narrow complex and there is tachycardia. This is SVT, supraventricular tachycardia. You should know some causes of it and the drug of choice. So drug of choice for supraventricular tachycardia is adenosine followed by beta blockers and calcium channel blockers. Okay. Here you have a tachycardia. Heart rate is very high. You can see that the number of large squares is 1.5 large squares. So 300 divided by 1.5. So the heart rate is around 200 here. But you see the QRS complex is broad. So this is what we call it as a broad complex tachycardia or a wide complex tachycardia. Broad complex tachycardia or wide complex tachycardia, which is regular. This is the classical ventricular tachycardia. So VT, this is how the VT would be looking like. So how do we manage VT? If the patient is hemodynamically unstable, you will have to cardiovert the patient. If the patient is hemodynamically stable, BP is okay, patient is conscious, then the drug of choice is lignocaine followed by amiodarone. Okay, amiodarone, lignocaine, this is the drug of choice for VT. Okay. This is the most common arrhythmia that you get. Okay, you find that the QRS is coming irregular. You can see this, the QRS is irregularly irregular. It's not regular as you saw in the earlier ECGs, and the P waves are absent. And they're replaced. You can see it in lead V1 here. This is the baseline is thrown into waves. This is what we call it as the fibrillary waves. So this is atrial fibrillation, very, very common arrhythmias where you get irregular QRS complex. So irregularly irregular complex is atrial fibrillation. You have to know the causes of atrial fibrillation and how do you manage atrial fibrillation. Okay, so here again, you find there is an irregularity. You can see there 1, 2, 3, 4, then there is irregularity, 1, 2, 3, 4, there is irregularity there. So it's not atrial fibrillation because it's regularly coming. What you can carefully look at, you can see here, the first P wave you're seeing here, the PR interval and the QRS and the T. Next P wave, PR interval, QRS and T. Then the P wave, next PR interval. You can see what is happening to the PR interval. There is a progressive prolongation of the PR interval. And finally, one P wave is not conducted. P wave is dropped. So this is what we call it as a heart block. So this is the heart block where there is a progressive prolongation of the PR interval and a dropped beat. This is what we call it as Wenckebach phenomena or Mobitz type 2 heart block. So again, a very common arrhythmias. So you have to be able to identify this and tell some causes for it. Okay. Here, if you see, you're finding that the QRS is coming very, very wide apart. You can see that the QRS is here and the QRS is here. So number of large squares, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 large squares between the QRS. So 300 divided by 11. So the heart rate is very, very low. Okay, very, very low. It's less than 30 heart rate is. So this is bradycardia, severe bradycardia you see. Okay, so low heart rate. So whenever the heart rate is slow, low, you should remember one condition called as a complete heart block. If you can see here, the P waves is here. The QRS is here, the P wave again here, QRS. The P is going on its own, the QRS is going on its own. So this is what we call it as a complete heart block. So whenever you have heart blocks, the common causes of heart blocks is MI. MI is one of the important cause. Second cause of heart block, you have to remember, is drugs. Beta blockers, calcium channel blockers, and digoxin. These are three important drugs which can produce heart block. If an elderly person, 80-year-old person comes with heart block, it's a degenerative heart block. So these are the three important causes of heart block. Any heart block, remember, MI is a cause. Second is drugs. And third is degenerative heart diseases. So these are the common conditions which can produce heart block. Next, a very important lethal condition that you have to know on ECG, which you can diagnose, is hyperkalemia. You have to know the ECG changes, both in theory and practicals, they'll ask you. So ECG changes of hyperkalemia, you get tall T waves. You can see this. This is the QRS and this is the T waves. The T wave is so tall, tall tented T waves. Tall tented T waves you're finding everywhere. In some waves, it is more than the QRS you can see. Tall tented T waves is very, very characteristic of hyperkalemia. So it's a medical emergency. When you see this, you will have to start the patient on immediate anti-hyperkalemic treatment. You'll have to start them on calcium gluconate. You'll have to start them on insulin dextrose. You'll have to nebulize them with salbutamol. And if it is not reverting and potassium is anywhere above 8, you will have to dialyze the patient also. Okay. So that is how you treat hyperkalemia. It's one of the medical emergencies. Some of the VIVAs, they don't give anything. They just ask you some medical emergency, general VIVA, where they ask you medical emergencies. And one of the common emergencies that they give is hyperkalemia. You should know how do you manage hyperkalemia. So these are the common ECGs that are there. That are the common things that are asked for you and how do you identify. Next, briefly about the common X-rays that are kept. You have a large number of X-rays. So it's out of the purview of such a small session where we are mixing up everything. When the X-ray is given, the basic thing that you have to make out is whether it is a cardiac predominant problem or it is a respiratory problem. So that is the first thing that you have to differentiate. Next, you should know whether it's an AP view or a PA view. So that's common things that they ask. And then you should know what is the abnormality that you're going to describe. So supposedly, this is the first X-ray which I'm showing you. So how do you know it's an AP view or a PA view? Simple thing, please look at the fundic gas shadow below the left diaphragm. If you're able to see the fundic gas shadow, That means the patient is standing. So this is a PA view. The chest X-ray PA view. If the fundic gas shadow is not seen, that means it's an AP view. So this is one simple thing that you can identify. There are other ways also, because remember, in a AP view, you can see the entire spine. Here, the entire spine is not seen. So it's a PA view. Next is, you can see the scapula. You can see the scapula. Scapula should be outside the film in case of a PA view. Whereas in an AP view, the scapula will be within the film. So these are the three simple ways, but the common one, please remember, is your fundic gas shadow that you see. So once you said it's a PA view, next is you want to differentiate whether it's a cardiac or a respiratory. So basic thing is look for cardiomegaly. So how do you measure cardiomegaly? You have to calculate the cardiothoracic ratio. So draw a line in the midpoint here and measure the maximum cardiac diameter. So maximum cardiac diameter on right side, maximum cardiac diameter is on the left side. So the total that, so that is the cardiac diameter. And then calculate the thoracic diameter. The maximum thoracic diameter is at the CP angles here. Now, if the cardiothoracic ratio is more than 50%, that means the heart is occupying more than 50% in a PA view, that means there is cardiomegaly. Okay, in a PA view, if the heart is occupying more than 50%, that is cardiomegaly. On an AP view, it should be more than 60%. Okay, so this is cardiomegaly. Once there is cardiomegaly, look if you can identify certain structures that are there. Please remember the structures which form the heart border. Okay, this is commonly asked. This is the aorta. Left heart border is formed by the aortic knuckle here. Then you have the pulmonary artery that comes here. And this is the left ventricle. Please remember, this is the left ventricle. This part normally is empty. But here you can see one additional structure that has come, which is not normal. This is a site where you get the left atrial appendage. So please remember, top is aortic knuckle, pulmonary artery. This is the left atrial appendage, which is not normally seen. And this is the left ventricle. So this is left atrial appendage. So this patient has a mitral valve disease. Okay. The right heart border is formed by the right atrium. So this is the right atrium. This is left ventricle. This is the only two structures of the chambers of the heart, which you can see. Left atrium is not seen directly and right ventricle cannot be seen on a PA view. What you're seeing here, hopefully all of you are able to see, is the prosthetic valve. You can see this prosthetic valve. It is a metallic prosthetic valve. So this is a post-valveoplasty. Patient has undergone a valve replacement. Now, which valve is it? Is it a mitral valve or an aortic valve? Simple. You draw a line from the right cardiophrenic angle to the left hilum. So you're going to draw a line like this, line from here to here. If you have the prosthetic valve below it, it is mitral. If you have a valve above this line, it is aortic. So this is a mitral valve prosthesis. So this is an X-ray of a post-mitral valve replacement that has been done. Okay, anybody quickly can tell me what is the diagnosis? Is it a cardiac or a respiratory X-ray?
Cardiac.
So here you find that there is a gross cardiomegaly. You can see that there's a cardiomegaly that you can see here. And what you can see, the left heart border, what has happened? I showed you the pulmonary aorta, pulmonary left atrium, etc. Here, the left heart border has become straight. Straightening of left heart border. Straightening of left heart border. That's a classical sign of mitral valve disease. And you can see the right heart border. I told you this is right atrium that you're seeing here. You're seeing here one more atrium. So this is left atrium. This is right atrium. This is called as a double atrial shadow or shadow within the shadow, double atrial shadow. Please remember the inside one here is the left atrium. The one which is arising from down is the right atrium. So this is again a mitral valve disease. So it's a cardiomegaly due to mitral valve disease. Okay. So here you find a gross cardiomegaly. You can see that there is a heart is very, very huge, gross cardiomegaly. And if you carefully look at the border, it looks like stenciled heart border. Stenciled, as if you're drawn a line there. Very clear, distinct heart border. This is called as pericardial effusion. So this is pericardial effusion, where you have a money bag appearance. Okay, a narrow pedicle, a broad base, and you find a stenciled heart border. Stenciled heart border. pericardial effusion. Again, here you can see there, you can see that there is a cardiomegaly, and you can see this border very clear, stenciled, as if you have drawn a line like this, stenciled heart border. So this is again pericardial effusion. Okay, so those were the cardiac common x-rays that are kept. Mitral valve disease is usually kept, and pericardial effusion. These are the two common things that are kept for undergraduates. Postgraduates, they'll ask you some other x-rays also. Now here are the respiratory x-rays. If you see here, whenever you see the respiratory x-rays, the first thing that you look for is the tracheal position. Is the trachea central or it is displaced? Is it displaced to one side or both sides? Is it shifted? That's what you're going to look for. Based on that, you can decide which disease is there or not. Next, you look for the zones. So the respiratory lung is divided into three zones, upper zone, mid zone, and lower zone. Up to the second rib is the upper zone. Second to fourth rib is the mid zone. And below the fourth rib is the lower zone that you see. So here you're finding shadows in all the zones, upper, mid, and lower zones. What sort of shadows? Non-homogeneous. This is non-homogeneous. It's not a homogeneous shadow. It's a non-homogeneous shadow that you're seeing. So, and in this non-homogeneous shadows, you're finding some black round shadows, small cystic shadows like, okay, they are small cavities that you see. And these are the interstitial shadows or the fluffy shadows, we call it. This is the characteristic appearance of tuberculosis. So this is how active tuberculosis would look like. So you're finding non-homogeneous opacities with small cystic shadows and fluffy shadows in upper, mid, and lower zone that you see. This x-ray, if you see, you're finding a homogeneous shadow. See, this is a homogeneous shadow. It's a round shadow you're seeing, a round shadow in the right mid and lower zone, right mid and lower zone, you're finding a homogeneous round shadow. So this is what we call it as a nodule or a mass lesion. So it could be benign, it could be malignant. This is how a homogeneous shadow would look like. Again, you're finding here is a homogeneous shadow. You can see that there is a homogeneous shadow in the left mid zone. Okay, it could be a mass, it could be a benign mass, it could be a malignant mass. So these are how the shadows would look like. Now here, what you're finding is one-sided lung is totally white. So what we call it as a homogeneous opacity in the entire right side of the lung. Right side of the lung, entire white. And the trachea is shifted to the same side. So see this, the trachea is shifted to the same side. So whenever you have this white lung, you should see the position of the trachea. If the trachea is shifted to the same side, that means it is collapse of the right lung, collapse of the right lung. In contrast, you can see this, here you have a homogeneous opacity on the left side, but the trachea is shifted to the opposite side. Trachea is shifted to the opposite side. So the diagnosis here will be pleural effusion. So left-sided pleural effusion. So if the trachea is shifted to the opposite side, it's pleural effusion. Trachea is shifted to the same side, it is collapse. Okay. So here you're finding again a non-homogeneous opacity. It's not as homogeneous as you saw here. And you can see some black lines that are going through that. This is what we call it as the air bronchograms. You can see these black lines which are going. So this is how a consolidation would look like or a mnemonic patch will look like. Again, you can see here, there is a almost homogeneous shadow here. And you can see this is the fissure, interlobar fissure that is there. And it is bulged down. It's bulging down with the homogeneous opacity here, some air bronchograms here, and a bulging fissure. Very characteristic of a pneumonia, upper lobe pneumonia, which is caused secondary to Klebsiella. This is a very common x-ray that is kept. You can see that there are multiple round shadows. You can see that round shadows, multiple shadows that you can see there. This is what we call it as cannonball appearance. This is secondaries, cannonball secondaries that you can see, cannonball secondaries. This is metastasis, usually from the breast. It could be from the thyroid. It could be due to the genital organs. Again, this is also an x-ray you can see there. Multiple round shadows, that is the cannonball secondaries that you can get, cannonball secondaries that you could get. So it could occur from the GI tract also. Could be choriocarcinoma also. So those are the shadows which were white. Now we are seeing shadows where it is black. You can see that this part, the left side of the lung, is totally black. In contrast to the right, trachea is shifted to the right. You have a total homogeneous white black lung that's there. And you can see here the collapsed lung margin, or what we call it as the visceral pleural line. This is the pneumothorax of the left side. So left-sided pneumothorax. This is a black lung that you can see. And there are no markings. There are no markings that you see there. Here, again, you have a black hypertranslucent C on the right side. No marking C. And you can see the collapsed lung margin here. And the trachea shifted to the left side. So this is pneumothorax on the right side. So right-sided pneumothorax you can see. In this X-ray, you can see that there is a pneumothorax here. You have seen the collapse margin you're seeing here. But along with that, you're finding an air fluid level. There is an air fluid level here. There is fluid here, air above. So this is a hydropneumothorax. Right-sided hydropneumothorax. What has happened to the lung? You can see that the lung has non-homogeneous opacities. What we saw in the first X-ray, small cavities you can see there. Non-homogeneous opacity. So this is suggestive of tuberculosis, and that is also hydropneumothorax. This is a very common X-ray that is kept. You can see all over the lungs, all over the zones, upper zone, mid zone, lower zone of both sides, you're finding small dots, no? small dots that you're seeing there. Very, very small, 1 to 3 millimeter size. This is what we call it as the miliary mottling or the miliary shadowing. Okay. It's not miliary tuberculosis. One of the differential diagnoses is miliary tuberculosis, but this X-ray is miliary mottling. Please remember the other causes of miliary mottling. You could get it in case of miliary tuberculosis. The second most important cause is tropical pulmonary eosinophilia. You can get it in fungal infections. You can get it in pneumocystis. You can get it in silicosis, asbestosis, sometimes in sarcoidosis. And you can get it in certain malignancies, what we call it as the lymphangio, when the lymphatic spread is there, lymphangiocarcinomatosis that happens, especially in CA breast, you can get this miliary mottling. Viral pneumonias like chickenpox can also have this miliary mottling, like picture that could happen. Hemosiderosis can also have miliary mottling. It's a very important question that's asked for you in your theory. Name some 4 or 5 causes of miliary mottling that you have to. Here, if you look at, you're finding a cavity. There is a cavity, and inside the cavity, you're finding a fluid level. So you have a cavity with air fluid level in the right lower zone. This is the lung abscess. This is lung abscess. So lung abscess, you're finding a cavity with air fluid level. Here, you're finding a chest X-ray here. You're finding a multiple cystic spaces. If you can see in the left side, can show you multiple cystic spaces that you're seeing here all over the lung fields. It looks like a honeycombing appearance. Okay, honeycombing appearance. So this is what we mean by bronchiectasis. Bronchiectasis will have this appearance. You're finding a round shadow here, and there is a homogeneous opacity. In the periphery, you're finding air. You're finding air in the periphery. Okay, this is what we call it as an air crescent sign. Okay, fungus ball. It's a classical of aspergilloma. Aspergilloma, as a sequel of the tuberculosis, the fungus ball will come. So it's an aspergilloma. It's not aspergillosis, it is aspergilloma. Here, you're finding a homogeneous opacity here. Okay, the CP angle is blunted. So it's a pleural effusion, but it is not occupying the entire area. You can see that it is taking a shape here. It is like a D shape. It is loculated. So this is how you get a pleural effusion, which is loculated to one side. Usually this is empyema. Empyema will appear like this. This is one of the X-rays which we already discussed, a similar X-ray we discussed that time. You're finding a opacity in the right lower zone here with air bronchograms. This is consolidation. Again, whenever you have a shadow like this, which lobe is it arising from? Is it arising from the middle lobe, or is it arising from the lower lobe of the lung? How do you make out it? You have to see the right heart border. If the right heart border is clearly seen, it is lower lobe. Here, the right heart border is obscured. So middle lobe is involved. So middle lobe obscures the right heart border. This is what we call it as the Sillot sign or the Silvay sign. This is the most common case in your exam that is kept for you in respiratory system is your COPD. COPD, emphysema. What are the features that you can see? You can see there is hypertranslucency. You're finding the lung is appearing very black. The vascular markings are less. The heart has become tubular. It has become tubular. The diaphragm has been shifted down. Normally, you get it at around the 10th rib. Here it is gone below that. Or the 6th anterior or 10th posterior, you might get it. No, it's gone much below that. The ribs are widely spaced and you can see there is a widening of the spaces that you're seeing there. So these are all the features. And the diaphragm is flattened. Normally, diaphragm has that contour like this. It is like this, a dome shape. Here it has become flat. So all these features are suggestive of emphysema. So this is an X-ray of a emphysema that you get. This is the same X-ray which I showed. I won't go on. Okay. So here you have a lateral X-ray of the skull, which is showing multiple punched out lesions. Punched out lesions, you can see that. Punched out lesions in the skull. So this is the classical X-ray that you get in case of multiple myeloma. Multiple myeloma, you do get this finding. This is the same. You can see the multiple lytic lesions you get on the various part of the skulls that you can see. This is again an X-ray of miliary mottling. You should know the differential diagnosis for the miliary mottling. This is again, you have a thick walled cavity with the air fluid level. This is how the lung abscess would look like. This is a cardiomegaly. You can see that there is a cardiomegaly. So is it pericardial effusion or it's a valvular problem?
Valvular, sir.
So you have to make out the borders and see if you're able to see the borders clearly. So if you see here, there is a bulge here. This is the pulmonary artery which is coming out there. So, okay, it's not a stenciled heart border to cause a pericardial effusion. So you have a big pulmonary artery that's there. And here is the left ventricle. And the pulmonary base, this left atrial appendage has come here. So this is again a mitral valve disease. Okay, mitral valve disease producing the X-ray. Here you have an X-ray here, which is again a cardiac X-ray. You can see the cardiomegaly. You can see the pulmonary aorta here, pulmonary artery being very, very prominent. And here the left ventricle. The left atrium is not there. You can see this part. Left atrium is not come there. Left atrial appendage is not come. And you're finding a huge pulmonary artery. You can see this descending branch of pulmonary artery. Very characteristic. And the pulmonary looks very, very white there. Lot of flow there. There is plethora, pulmonary plethora. And a huge pulmonary artery. This is the congenital heart disease. Okay, ASD, atrial septal defect. This is how the X-ray would look like. You can classically describe the X-ray as something called as a jug handle appearance. Okay. This is the jug and this is the handle. The pulmonary artery looks like a handle here and this is the jug. Okay. So jug handle appearance of atrial septal defect. Here you're finding that the diaphragm is elevated. So right diaphragm is elevated. So you'll have to know some causes of the elevated diaphragm. So it could be due to diaphragmatic paralysis or it could be due to fibrosis or collapse of lung or something pushing the diaphragm from down. What are you finding here? You can see this. Under the diaphragm, you're finding gas, pneumoperitoneum. So air under the diaphragm. You should know the cause. It's usually due to hollow viscous perforation. You can get it in some other conditions, but most often is due to hollow viscous perforation. What is this?
Chaladiti.
Okay, so again, you have your air under the diaphragm you're seeing here. But the air is not freely there. It's there in the colon, isn't it? You can see the colon here. Ostrations you can see there. So this is the interposition of the colon between the diaphragm and the liver. So this is what we call it as the Chaladiti syndrome. Chaladiti syndrome. Very common in your X-rays in the surgery set, you do get this. Yes. What is this? So you find that there is shadows which is coming around the hilum. You can see this. This is the hilum here. around the hilum, you're seeing the shadows. It takes a shape like a bat wing appearance. You can see that bat wing appearance. So bat wing appearance, it could be due to pulmonary edema. It could be due to ARDS also. So this is the bat wing appearance of pulmonary edema that you get. Sometimes they keep some CTs which are expected undergraduates to know. So you can see this CT here. You find that there is a shadow here. Density. You can see the change in the density here on the right side. You can see it on the left also. The left one is on the left side you're seeing. You can see it here. So what is this? So what is it? So here you have a shape of it. It is a concavo-convex shape that is there. So this is suggestive of a subdural hematoma. Subdural hematoma. Whereas if you have a biconvex shape, okay, biconvex shape shadow, you can see this biconvex shadow, it is extradural hematoma. So extradural hematoma will have a biconvex, whereas subdural has a concavo-convex that is there. Next you have a hemorrhage. This is the intracerebral hemorrhage. This is how a hemorrhage will look on a CT. And this is how an infarct will look on a CT. When you have an acute stroke patient, this is how the infarct will look like. Okay. And this is the hemorrhage how it looks like. So hemorrhage will look like hyperdense. This is you're finding a lesion in the brain. And around the lesion, you have enhancement. This is what we call it as a ring enhancing lesion. So ring enhancing lesion on the CT. So ring enhancing lesion on a MRI. So what are the differential diagnosis for ring enhancing lesion? It could be a tuberculoma. It could be any other space occupying lesions. It could be a cryptococcus, toxoplasma. It could be a brain abscess. It could be a malignancy. So these are all the differential diagnosis for the ring enhancing lesion. So ring enhancing lesion based on the size, based on the location, based on the multiplicity. It could be neurocysticercosis when you have multiple of them. So this is the differential diagnosis for a ring enhancing lesion that you see. So with that, we have finished the common images that are kept. Coming on to the drugs. So again, this is the most widest thing. Any drug can be asked. Any drug, even if the drug is not in the drug tray that is available, they can ask you about drugs. So there is no limit for asking on which drugs. So what are the common things that they're going to ask you? They are going to ask you is the indication. What type of drug is it? What group it is belonging to? And what is the mechanism of action? And if at all, they'll ask you, what are the side effects of the drug possible? So what are the common drugs that you have to know thoroughly? Please remember antihypertensive agents. So you should remember the classification. What are the common drugs that come under that category you should know? And you should also know, what are the examples for each? ACE inhibitors, ARBs. What are the contraindications for each? And what are the complications that can happen? Supposedly, if you have ACE inhibitors, the absolute contraindication is where there is a renal artery stenosis or the creatinine. If it is more than 2.5, then you do not give it. What are the complications that can happen with ACE/ARB? The commonest complication that you would encounter is allergic cough they could develop. So they could have cough that could develop, and that is one of the common side effects. If you say beta blockers are contraindicated in asthma. Beta blockers are contraindicated if there is a peripheral vascular disease. What are the side effects of beta blockers? Beta blockers can produce bradycardia. They can produce heart blocks, and they are contraindicated in certain conditions. So you have to know the common drugs, the common side effects of them in antihypertensives. You have to know some new antihypertensive agents. So you have the newer antihypertensive agents which have come. If you have the calcium channel blockers, you have the cilnidipine that is there, you have a direct renin inhibitor called as elesiran, your newer ACRBs that is there, olmesartan, etc., valsartan, etc., are the newer drugs that are available. Next category of drugs they commonly ask you is the anti-diabetic drugs. So again, you have to know which category it belongs to. You should know the example. If metformin is there, it's a biguanide. If voglibose is there, it's alpha-glucosidase inhibitor. You should know SGLT2. You should know DPP-4 inhibitors, what are gliptins, you should know about that. And you should know common side effects of these. Most of them will cause hypoglycemia. Some of them do not cause hypoglycemia, like your acarbose doesn't cause, will not cause hypoglycemia. Your SGLT2 inhibitors are not known to cause hypoglycemia. You should know in which patients we'll use which. In obese patients, what do we use? Next, you have to know about insulins. Insulin is a very common drug that is kept. So you should know insulin, name some newer insulins, and what are the side effects of insulin. Very common question they ask you is, how do you manage hypoglycemia? Please remember hypoglycemia. If the patient is taking orally, you have to give them oral glucose and see. If the patient is unconscious, then we'll have to give the patient parenteral glucose. And if the long-acting drugs are there, then possibly we may have to give the patient glucagon also. So that is also very much important when we discuss the treatment of diabetes, hypoglycemia, and how do you manage hypoglycemia is very commonly asked. Okay. So that's about the diabetic agents. Again, remember insulin other than diabetes. Where do we use insulin other than diabetes?
Hyperkalemia.
Okay, in hyperkalemia, you use insulin. So you have to remember that also. Next group of drugs that you're supposed to know is the anti-tubercular drugs. I think we have discussed about anti-tubercular drug in detail in the TB section when I took. So you have to know the dosing. What is the mnemonic I told you that time? So the dosing of INH, rifampicin, ethambutol, pyrazinamide, and streptomycin, you have to remember per kg, 5, 10, 15, 20, and 25 per kg. You should know the common side effects. INH produces what? Rifampicin produces what? You have to know some drugs which are used for the treatment of MDR therapy. So again, anti-tubercular drugs is very commonly asked. Next group of drugs they ask you is anti-epileptic. So Eptoin, phenobarbital, carbamazepine, sodium valproate. The newer drugs, levetiracetam or lamotrigine, topiramate, all those things. So you should know the classification, and they'll ask you the management of status epilepticus. That's a common thing they ask. Next group of drugs which are usually kept are the emergency drugs. Adrenaline, atropine, furosemide, hydrocortisone, dexamethasone, noradrenaline, dopamine, calcium gluconate, sodium bicarbonate. So these are the common emergency drugs which are kept in the emergency drug tray. You have to know in which condition that we use it. That is what you have to important. Next is anti-malarial therapy. Very important. You have to know about chloroquine. You have to know about primaquine, quinine, and artisunate. You have to know thoroughly about artisunate combination therapy. Next group of drugs they commonly ask is the antibiotics. So any antibiotic they can ask you, the classification, they can ask you the side effects and the uses and other indications. Common antibiotics they ask is metronidazole, aminoglycosides, quinolones, levofloxacin, moxifloxacin they ask you. So these are the common drugs that they ask you for in your VIVAs. Next is the nebulized solutions. What are the various nebulized solutions you know of, or bronchodilator classification and the uses of the bronchodilators. Diuretics, you have to know what are the uses of diuretics, and poisoning management. So whenever in drugs, they'll ask you about is any of the emergency management. So please remember emergencies under each chapter and read about the emergency management, acute MI, acute asthma, status epilepticus, anaphylaxis, how do you manage? So what are the drugs that are used? So they'll ask you, pick up the drugs in this tray, which are used for the management of acute asthma. Then you'll have to pick up steroid. You'll have to pick up nebulized solutions. You'll have to pick up the derifilin maybe. Okay. If they ask you to pick up the drugs which are used for the management of anaphylaxis, then you'll have to possibly pick up adrenaline, a steroid, and a chlorpheniramine. You'll have to pick up those. So this is the common VIVA question that you ask. Also, please read a little about the antiretroviral drugs. Of late, they ask you about antiretroviral drugs and thyroid. Thyroid, the treatment of thyroid is also asked. So that's about the drugs that is asked. So again, it's a very vast topic. There is no limit of what can be asked, but usually they ask common things only. The charts which are kept in the exam, I think we have a little, I'll just briefly, I think we have already crossed 1.5 hours. Briefly, I'll tell about the charts which are kept. Commonly, the charts that are kept is either a lab data or a clinical problem. So clinical problem or lab data. So clinical scenarios can be kept where a patient has a particular findings that are there. Patient's history is given, and then they give some lab data. You find that there is a hemoglobin is low and you find this peripheral smear like this, they might give you an image of the peripheral smear. You find that there are target cells. You can see that target cells very classically, microcytic, hypochromic with target cells. So you know what's the diagnosis, and that is thalassemia. Thalassemia is the diagnosis that you say. And they can ask you a list of questions. What's your diagnosis? And what are the complications that could happen? And what are the treatment that you can do for this patient? And what are the genetic basis of this statement? So based on the clinical scenario and the image that is kept, they can ask you questions. So the common laboratory abnormalities, they keep hepatitis, renal failure, thyroid dysfunction, diabetes, diabetic ketoacidosis. Please remember, this is a very common VIVA. In your VIVA emergency, they ask you management of diabetic ketoacidosis. Please read about it and tell it properly. So these are the common things that can be asked. Sometimes they can ask you about a PFT, and you can see that here you're finding that the patient has a reduced FEV1, and after bronchodilator, you can see the bronchodilator, after post-bronchodilator, you're finding that there is almost a you can see that there is a significant improvement that you're seeing there, pre-bronchodilator and post-bronchodilator studies. So this means this is a obstructive airway disease which is reversible. So they can ask you what is the diagnosis? Is it asthma? Is it COPD? And how do you manage the case? So they can give you a ABG interpretation. They can give you an interpretation of a smear that could be there. And based on that, they can ask you the question. Some of the centers, they have microscopy, which is kept. And the common microscopic things they keep is AFB. Sometimes they keep malaria. Sometimes they keep microcytic anemia they could keep. So very few things, either microcytic iron deficiency anemia, sometimes megaloblastic anemia, sometimes leukemia is kept, AFB smear is kept, and sometimes they keep urine and showing certain findings. So not all universities keep, but some of the universities still keep microscopy. Some universities keep the soft specimens also of lung, kidney, etc. And they ask you some questions on that in your VIVA. So this is the common things that are asked in your general VIVA. So instruments, the X-rays are common in most of the universities. Instrument and X-rays are commonly used. ECGs, of late, almost all universities are asking ECGs for VIVAs. And then the one VIVA is a general VIVA, but they ask you about emergencies. Drugs, almost all the universities, there is one station on drugs. And sometimes they keep charts also. So these are the common things that are asked in your VIVAs. Hopefully, I have covered most of it. If there are any questions or any clarifications, you can ask. Any questions or clarifications?
One question that was asked was the cutoff for thrombocytopenia for LP.
It's not the absolute value, it's the disease that is progressing. Supposedly, you find a disease where you have a rapidly falling platelets, then possibly you would not touch, because when you do the procedure and when the platelet count is done, it depends on that. Supposedly, you think that the platelet count is 50,000. Okay, above 1 lakh, even neurosurgical procedures can be done. Above 50,000, you can do major surgeries. So 50,000 and above is safe. Less than that is always a risk. Again, please remember, it's about what platelet and what time you're doing the procedure. Supposedly, you've done a platelet one day earlier and doing the procedure next day, the platelets might have dropped much less. So it's a little risky. Whenever there's thrombocytopenia, especially less than 50,000, it's risky to do a lumbar puncture. Above 50,000, above 1 lakh, definitely safe. That's not the same for bone marrow. Okay, bone marrow you can do even at lesser platelets. Up to 5,000, 10,000 you can do bone marrow. Any other questions? No.
One question on YouTube is because of the COVID pandemic, what are the X-ray features that is present in COVID?
Of COVID, COVID will have various patterns are there, okay? But remember, the COVID does not produce a classical pneumonia, does not produce lobar pneumonia. So what is against COVID is a lobar pneumonia. Cavities, okay? Cavities like what you see in tuberculosis is against COVID. Pleural effusion, okay? A classical massive pleural effusion. These three patterns are against COVID. All other patterns can be possible. You can get a pneumothorax, you can get interstitial shadows, you can get the bat wing appearance, you can get fluffy shadows, okay? All other patterns are possible. What is not possible is a lobar pneumonia, pleural effusion, okay, significant pleural effusion, and cavities, big cavities. These three things are unlikely in COVID. Otherwise, any other pattern, be it nodular, miliary, bigger than miliary, all shadows can be seen in COVID.
What about the site of bone marrow aspiration in a patient who is obese?
Patient who is?
Obese patient.
Obese, huh? The obese patient, I think the easiest site is the sternum. Only thing, we'll have to put the guard, measure it and put it. Okay. Measure the depth. When you're using a, when you're giving lignocaine, you'll be knowing what juncture the bone is at. And you make sure that the guard is put properly. You can easily do it at the sternum. You can do it anywhere at the iliac crest. Even in an obese patient, the anterior part of the iliac crest is easily palpable. You can do it anywhere in the iliac crest. Okay. You can do it in the iliac crest anywhere. It might be a little difficult, but maybe the length of the needle, etc., because the amount of the fat it has to go through, but it is possible. You can do bone marrows in obese patients in the sternum or the anterior part of the iliac crest. Posterior might be a little difficult.
How to tell the bronchovascular markings are normal on chest X-ray?
How they are normal or increased? Huh?
Yes.
Again, remember the vascular markings. Now, the problem with the present X-ray versus earlier X-rays, the earlier X-rays, the big ones, I think even many of the exam set of X-rays are the old big ones X-rays, are the traditional X-rays. Okay. If you divide the lung into three zones laterally, not the upper zone, mid zone, lower zone, from the medial third, the middle third, and lateral third. The lateral third of the lung should be black, should not be having any vascular, white marking should not be there. If you find markings going on to the lateral third of the lung, that means there is increased bronchovascular markings, vascular markings, okay? And bronchi generally follow the vascular territory itself. So if you find the lateral third of the X-ray also has some white lines, that means there is increased bronchovascular markings. The problem with the smaller X-rays, the digital X-rays, what we get at present is because of the digital X-rays that are taken, you may find markings up to the periphery. So all these rules which were used for traditional X-rays become null and void when we take the digital X-rays. Digital X-rays, you might find certain. But yes, in the lateral third, it should relatively be avascular, should be only black. If you find it there, that means there is more vascular shadows in the periphery, what we call it as a plethora.
This question is a little unrelated, sir. Efficacy of COVID vaccine.
Efficacy of COVID vaccine? I think studies are still going on. It's too early to say, but yes, supposedly it has an efficacy of above 60% for severe disease. It still can produce, people can still get COVID, can transmit COVID, but for severe disease, it is protective. COVID is something like BCG for tuberculosis. It prevents the severe complications of the disease.
What are the differential diagnoses for a non-homogeneous opacity? One more question.
Again, non-homogeneous opacity, it is depends upon what sort of non-homogeneous opacity you're dealing. If you're seeing air bronchograms in a non-homogeneous opacity, it becomes consolidation predominantly. Sometimes with pulmonary edema, you can get it. If you're seeing cavities, that's there. If you're seeing discrete cavities, then it is tuberculosis or bronchiectasis that comes. If you're seeing reticular, more of lines that you're seeing, it becomes all your interstitial shadows, either ILD or interstitial pneumonias. If you're finding nodular shadows, then it becomes your miliary or a mass lesion. So based on the type of non-homogeneous opacities, you do find the differential diagnosis, reticular pattern or alveolar pattern. Alveolar pattern means it is more of pneumonia. Reticular pattern, that is interstitial. So based on the pattern, you have the differential diagnosis. X-rays, ECGs are long classes, so I think I would not be able to clarify all these things just in this short time. Okay.
I think thank you so much for this wonderful session, sir. I think you've completely, for it is a need of the hour with all the exams coming up. And in between the session, there's so many messages that have been we've been receiving about so many appreciation for this class and so much gratitude to this.
Thank you
so much for this
session. Best of luck for all your exams and do well. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.